In this video session, we shall solve and check incomplete quadratic equations. What do I mean by incomplete quadratic equations? Incomplete quadratic equations are quadratic equations in which maybe one term is missing, maybe the second term is missing, or the third term is missing. Please, before you continue with this video, it is highly recommended. It is highly recommended that you view all the videos on factoring. Factoring has a lot. Factor by GCF, factor by grouping, factor by difference of two squares, factor by factoring quadratic trinomials. It is important that you view those videos. Okay? Very important that you view those videos. And then after that, you view the videos on a solution of quadratic equations, solving quadratic equations. It's important you view them as well. So you recall that if you recall the general form, of a quadratic equation. The general form of a quadratic equation is what? Is ax squared plus bx plus c equal to 0. And in the videos we did on factoring, of course, ax squared is the first term, bx is the second term, and c is the third term. Ax squared is the first term, bx is the second term, and then c is the third term. Okay, so in this video we shall look at quadratic equations in which the second term is missing or the third term is missing. Now, if the first term, some people might ask me, okay, what if the first term is missing? Well, if the first term is missing, guess what? What will happen? If the first term is missing, right? Then what will happen? What's going to happen? That means it is not a quadratic equation anymore. It's a linear equation. Okay? So if the first term is missing, it's a linear equation. So for it to still be a quadratic equation, it must have all these three terms, which is complete. This is a complete form. Complete form. Okay, complete form is this. The three terms are complete. That is complete forms. But when you don't have these three terms being complete, okay, then it's incomplete. Incomplete quadratic equation. For instance, if you look at number one, what is missing in number one? The third term is missing in number one. Third term missing. Number two, what is missing? Second term is missing in number two. The second term is the one with the variable. As the linear term, the second term is kind of the linear term. First term is like the quadratic term because of the x squared. Then x1 is linear. Then the third term is a constant. So number two, the second term is missing. Number three, what is missing? Second term is also missing in number three. Now, number four and number five, we shall, you know, you can argue. You can argue that number four and number five are not incomplete. You can argue that. Okay, we can argue that because when you expand it, you can still get a complete form. But, you know, we shall also try to do it another way. That's why I put it. I put those two questions so we can do it another way. So I'm going to use two methods to do number four and number five. We shall solve and check. Okay, we shall solve and check. First method, when the third term is missing, when the third term is missing, What do you want to do? Number one, you set the quadratic equation to be zero. Set the quadratic equation to be zero. In other words, make zero to be on the right hand side, okay? Which is okay there. And in other words, make zero to be on the right hand side. To be on the right hand side. Okay? I know why I'm saying this, because assuming I put, you know what, we can put another equation here so you can see what I'm talking about. We can write number two to be maybe, let's say we have 3x squared equal to 27x. So you see what I'm talking about. And then we can call this number three. We can call this number four. So, I wrote this so that you can see what I'm talking about. You always want to set this to, you always want zero to be on the right hand side first. That's what you want. Okay, so after that, okay, you factor by GCF, and then the next one, you now use zero product property. Please, we talked about this in the complete quadratic equation. So, use zero product property. Number four, solve and check. When the third term is missing. So let's look at number one. Number one is already, the third term is missing, right? Remember, this is the complete term. Ax squared plus bx plus c equal to zero. This is the complete form. So here, the third term is missing, but it's already equal to zero. So this condition is satisfied. Now let's factor by GCF. If you factor the left-hand side by GCF, you can say factor the left-hand side by GCF. So when we do that, we have P minus 14 equal to zero. See that? And then you do what? You use the zero product property. So P is equal to zero, or P minus 14 is equal to zero. So P is equal to zero, or P is equal to 14. 0 plus 14, which is 14. That's the answer. Now, what do you do next? You solve and check. We have solved it. Now, let's check our work. When you check, you check with the main equation. Check. You check with the main equation. We have P squared minus 14P is 0. Left-hand side. Right-hand side. Left-hand side is P squared minus 14P. Right-hand side is 0. So we'll have to check with both of them. If P is equal to 0, this will be 0 squared minus 14 times 0. 0 minus 0, which is 0. 0, 0, that works. When P is equal to 14, that will be 14 squared minus 14 times 14. Of course, 14 squared, even if I don't want to calculate it, this is 14 squared minus 14 squared, which is still 0. 0, 0, 0. So it works. Okay? Now let's do number 2. Number 2, if you have 3x squared equal to 27x, okay? So what you want to do here is, you have to set this to be equal to 0. So that means, bring this guy over here. Don't solve it this way. If you solve it this way, you might get only one answer. Like, let's say if you divide both sides by 3x, you're going to end up with only one answer. Okay, you want to, first of all, set this to be equal to 0. So this is 3x squared. This is still a case whereby the third term is missing. So this is 3x squared minus 27x equal to 0. That is the first thing you want to do first. And then you can now factor by GCF. This is 3x, x minus 9 equal to 0. And you have that 3x, you now solve by zero product property. 3x is 0 or x minus 9 is 0. So 3x is 0, x is 0 when you divide both sides by 3. Or x is equal to 9. 0 plus 9. That is it. Now, but the check in here will be kind of a little bit different, because when you check, you use the main equation. You write the main equation first. When you check, you have to use the main equation. You don't use the modified equation, no. Use the main one. Left hand side, right hand side. Now this is 3x squared, and this is 27x. Then we have to check for both of them. So when x is 0, this will be 3 times 0 squared, which is 3 times 0, which is 0. And this will be 27 times 0, which is 0. 0, 0, that works. That works. When x is 9, this will be 3 times 9 squared, okay, which is 3 times 81, which is what? 3 times 1 is 3, 3 times 8, 24, 243. 243, and here, this will be 27 times 9, right? 9 times 7 is 63, 3 carry 6. 9 times 2, 18 plus 6, 24, 243. Okay? Do you get it? That's the way you do it when the third term is missing. Now let's go to when the second term is missing. Let's do that. When the second term is missing, how do we solve this problem? The first thing we do is that we set the equation to be equal to c. We won't set it to be equal to 0 this time. We have to set the equation to be equal to c, the constant term. The third term, because here the second term is missing, so that means the third term is present. So well, the first thing we want to do is set the equation to be equal to the third term, which is the constant. Okay, of course that's the constant term. You set it to be equal to that. In other words, let the third term be on the right hand side. Okay? Let the third term be on the right hand side. Then number two, we now use what we call the square root property. Okay? Use the square root property. Which means take the square root of both sides. That's what it means. Take the square root of both sides. Okay, then after that, You now solve and check. Solve and check. Now, look, this property, this comes from the fact that, you know, when you have something like this, let me give you an example. Assuming you have maybe x squared to be equal to 4. Okay, if you say this in English, this means, what will you square? What will you multiply by itself? Okay, what will you square to give you 4? That is what this means. What are you going to, what will you square? Or what will you multiply by itself to give you 4? I know you just tell me that it's 2 because you take the square root of 4. And that gives you 2. Okay, now look up. 2 is known as the positive or principal square root. 2 is called the positive or principal square root. The positive or principal square root of 4. But what of negative 2? What about negative 2? What about negative 2? Because you know that 2 squared is 4. 2 squared is 4. Excuse me. But you also know that negative 2 all squared is negative 2 times negative 2. And that gives you what? It still gives you 4. So when we are using the square root property, we are going to consider both the positive square root and the negative square root. We are not only going to consider the positive square root. No. This is a quadratic equation. It must have 2 roots. A quadratic equation must have 2 solutions or 2 roots. So when the second term is missing, you will use the square root property, and that means the positive square root and the negative square root. Now this is the method you used in your quadratic formula and also in completing the square method. You read my videos on completing the square method, solving quadratic equations using completing the square method, and also solving quadratic equations using general formula or quadratic formula. Quadratic formula method, yeah, that's what it's called, quadratic formula method. Okay, so that is the way you do it. Instead of doing this like this, we will say that x squared is plus minus square root of 4. That is the way we will write it. X squared equal to plus minus square root of 4, which is now plus minus 2. So it tells you it is both 2 and also negative 2. So anytime we have square root, take the square root of both sides. Anytime we say use the square root property, when we use it on the right hand side, we will use the positive and negative square root of that. Okay, that is the square root property. Okay, now let's go ahead and solve. Let's solve the question 3 and question 4. When we have question 3, we have g squared minus 121 equal to 0. So the second term is missing here. So what do you do? But set the equation to be equal to the third term. So this is g squared. You push this over here. This is 121. And then you take the, you take the square root property. Take the square root of both sides. Use the square root property. So g will be plus or minus square root of 121. So g will be plus or minus 11. So that tells you that g is equal to 11, or g is equal to negative 11. That is what it tells you. If you want to check this, if you want to check it, we write the main problem first. G squared minus 121 equal to 0. Left hand side, right hand side. This will be g squared minus 121. This is 0. We do that for g equal to 11. This means 11 squared minus 121. That means 121 minus 121, which is 0. 0, 0. It works. Then we do g equal to negative 11. This is negative 11 all squared minus 121. Negative 11 times negative 11 is still 121. Now minus 121, which is 0. 0, 0. 0, 0. Okay? Now, you can do this another way. You can do this another method. Let me show you the method. Another way you can do this is this. Why you might want to do it that way is because 121 is a perfect square. And if you don't have a perfect square, you better just do it square root property. If you don't have a perfect square, you just do it square root property. Okay? But because this is 121 is a perfect square, if you want, you can do it this way. G squared minus 121 equal to 0. And then you can use the difference of two squares. Difference of two squares. So g squared minus 11 squared equal to 0. This will give you g plus 11 times g minus 11 equal to 0. Then you use the zero product property. Okay, from here you can now use zero product property. So g plus 11 equal to 0, or g minus 11 equal to 0. So g will be negative 11, or g equal to 11. Yeah, but if you're using this way, just is because it is a perfect square. Because 121 is a perfect square. If it's not a perfect square, don't do it that way. Okay, use square root property. Or if they ask you to use square root property, you use square root property. Okay, question 4. If we do question 4, 16 minus k squared equal to 0. So we can move this over here. 16 is k squared, so k squared is 16. So k will be plus minus square root of 16. K will be plus minus 4. Okay, so k is equal to 4, or k is minus 4. That is this. And if we need to check it, if we have to check it, what do we have? We can have, we write check. When we check, we use the main equation. 16 minus k squared is 0. Left hand side, right hand side. Left hand side is 16 minus k squared, right hand side 0. So when k is equal to 4, then this will be 16 minus 4 squared. 16 minus 16, that is 0. And when k is negative 4, that will be 16 minus minus 4 all squared. You see that? 16 minus k squared will be 16 minus, this minus is this minus. Then k is minus 4, put it in parentheses, all squared, which is 16 minus 16, which is still equal to 0. It works for both of them. Okay? Now, question 5. You know, I like using different methods to do stuff, to do problems. And if they don't ask you a particular method, then use the method that you like. You can still use this. If you still want, you can do this with difference of two squares. You know that, right? Because that would be 16 minus k squared equal to 0. This is 16. This will be 4 squared minus k squared equal to 0. Second method. I mean, if they didn't ask you a particular method to use, you can use this. But if they insist that you should use square root method, then you use the square root property. If they insist, you should use square root property. You use square root property. But if they just give it to you to solve, because 16 is the perfect square, you could still do this. You could still do this by difference of two squares. So this is 4 plus k, 4 minus k equal to 0. And then you can use 0 product property. Okay, 4 plus k is 0, or 4 minus k is 0. Here, right, k will be what? Negative 4. You move the 4 over here. Or here, 4 will be equal to k. Move k over here. So k will be equal to 4. So whichever one you like, I mean, that's up to you. Now, let's do question 5 and question 6. I'm going to use 2 methods to solve each of them. And whichever method you like, you use. But if they insist you should use the square root property, then you use the square root property. Question 5. You have x minus 3 all squared equal to 9. Okay. Can we do it the... can we first of all do it the long way first? And then we do it the short way. Honestly, the short way will be square root property. Because you're taking this as x squared. You're taking this as x squared. So the second term is missing. And you've already set this to be equal to the third term, 9. So that's the nice thing about this. Questions like this. Because you take this entity as x squared. You take this entity as x squared. And then second term is missing. And you set it to be equal to third term. So you can easily use the square root property to solve it. But if you are using the long way, this is what some folks will do. They want to expand this first. They come and say x minus 3 equal to 9. This is x squared minus 3x minus 3x plus 9 equal to 9. So x squared minus 6x plus 9 minus 9 equal to 0. So they will now say x squared minus 6x equal to 0. And they will say x. Then they will now use this when the third term is missing. They will now do this like when the third term is missing. X minus 6 equal to 0. Then use 0 product property. X is 0. Or x minus 6 is 0. So x is 0. Or x is 6. Alright, this is the long way. Let's do it the short way and then you see what I'm talking about. The short way you can do it. Okay, short way. Short method to do it. Maybe not call it second method. Okay, or you can use, either methods to do it. It doesn't matter. You can go ahead and take this as x squared, second term is missing. So, and you have already set it to be equal to the third term. You have set it to be equal to the third term. So go ahead and take square root of both sides. So you now have x minus 3 equal to plus minus square root of 9. Okay? X minus 3 equal to plus minus square root of 9. Because you're actually taking the square root of both sides. I mean, if you gotta write it like this, that's up to you. Equal to, but you have to put plus minus here, square root of 9. And then this is x minus 3. Equal to plus minus square root of 9. If you wanna write it first this way, that's fine. Okay? Yeah. If they insist to use this method, you have to use this method. So this is the method we use for completing the square method. If you view my videos on completing the square, you keep solving it until you get to this, and then you use this. So this will be 3 plus minus square root of 9. So x will be 3 plus minus 3. So x is 3 plus 3, or x is 3 minus 3. So x is 6 or x is 0. Whichever way. Which way is easier? Which way is shorter? Is it not this way? Okay, let's do what? Check our work. Let us check our work. And when we check with the main equation. X minus 3 all squared equal to 9. Left hand side, right hand side. Left hand side is x minus 3 all squared, right hand side 9. So we check with x equal to 0. Or we can start with 6, it doesn't matter. 6. So this will be 6 minus 3 all squared, which is what? 3 squared, which is what? 9. 9, 9. So 6 works. Then we check with x equal to 0. X equal to 0. So this will be 0 minus 3 all squared, which is minus 3 all squared, which is 9. 0 minus 3 is minus 3 all squared. Whether you say minus 3 or negative 3, it does not mean different things. It means the same thing. So some people might say negative 3. It doesn't matter. Okay. Alright. Last but not the least, question 6. Question 6, we have x plus 1 all squared minus 4 equal to 0. If you want to use the long method, you now have x plus 1 times x plus 1 minus 4 equal to 0. This is x squared plus x plus x plus 1 minus 4 equal to 0. This is x squared plus 2x minus 3 equal to 0. Alright, minus 3x squared. Minus 3x squared. 1 and minus 3. 1 minus 3 is 2. That won't work. But minus 1 plus 3 will work. See that? Minus 1 plus 3. Factoring quadratic trinomials. Need to view my video on it. Factoring quadratic trinomials. So this will be what now, folks? What will it be? It will be x minus 1 and x plus 3. So x minus 1 and x plus 3 equal to 0. So you use the zero product property. This means that x minus 1 is 0 or x plus 3 is 0. So x will be 1. Or x will be negative 3. Okay. That's the long method. Short method. We can take this case as incomplete form where the second term is missing. Okay. Now you see that you can make a case that this might, you know, in this way, this could be regarded as complete form. But you could make a case that this way, you could take it as incomplete form and then use the second, use the case whereby second term is missing. You can do that. So set this to be equal to the third term, 4. So x plus 1 all squared is equal to 4. And then use the square root property. So x plus 1 is plus minus square root of 4. Then x will be negative 1 plus minus square root of 4. Okay? Or if you want, you can say x plus 1 plus minus 2. Because some folks will say, why don't you just do plus minus 2 right away? That's fine. We could have x plus 1 equal to plus minus 2. So x will be negative 1 plus minus 2. Please, don't come here and put plus minus 2, then minus 1. Don't do that. If you do that, you mess up. Just put negative 1 plus minus 2. Okay, so x will be negative 1 plus 2, or x will be negative 1 minus 2. So this will be x equal to 1, or x equal to negative 3. The same thing. The same thing. All right. Next thing we do what is to do what? Check our work. And we check with the main problem. We check with the main problem. This is x plus 1 all squared minus 4 equal to 0. Left hand side, right hand side. Left hand side is x plus 1 all squared minus 4. Right hand side is 0. So we won't worry about the right hand side. We just make sure that what we get here is 0. Now when x is equal to 1, then we have 1 plus 1 all squared minus 4. This is 2 squared minus 4. This is 4 minus 4, 0. That works. That works. 1 works. We check for negative 3. When x is negative 3, this is negative 3 plus 1 all squared minus 4. Negative 2 all squared minus 4. 4 minus 4. Negative 3 works. Okay. And that is it. Alright, thank you so much for listening. Are you having a good evening?